Amen. Amen. Go ahead and grab a seat. Welcome, everyone. How's 9 a.m. today? All right. You guys warmed up a little bit this morning. It was a little chilly when I came out there. It's nice to be here with you today. My name is Pastor Greg. If we haven't met yet, thank you so much for being here. I know you could be anywhere, and yet you're choosing to be here, and that means so much to us. You know, it's been an incredible weekend as a church. You know, this entire year, we've been working really hard, and this church has had a really, really big heart, and we've been doing a lot. And there were two ministries that actually were launched out, became their own 501c3s, and they're their own thing, that had incredible events yesterday. Project SALT, which is right here inside of Wickenburg, serving and loving together, meeting the needs of the least of these, those who need a little bit of help here in our community of Wickenburg. Yesterday, they had a Christmas event that had over 100 children at it. And what I love is Project SALT, they had collected all the new items that came, and these kids were able to come in and Christmas shop for their parents. That's sweet. Yeah, I mean, that took place right here in this community. In addition to that, you know, there's an orphanage that we support in Kenya called Timothy's House. Timothy's House did a great event yesterday, a murder mystery dinner theater. I asked Pastor Rex about it. He said it was great. It was sold out and it did wonderful. And so that went on yesterday. And then yesterday morning, we had our men's ministry right here. There were tables set all the way from the front to the back, filled with men who are coming together to talk about Christians and Christmas. Hallelujah. And we were able to see just one Saturday all over this community. Lives were being touched and good things were happening. And I want you to know that happens because of you, because of your support, because of your vision, because of your help, and ultimately, though, because of your prayers. Because you're praying for this work and this ministry, and we just want to thank you so much. I want you to know this, you are making a difference on this earth. Some days we may not see it, but I'm going to tell you this weekend, let it be seen. You are a difference maker on this earth. Amen? Amen. I just want to celebrate that with you today. We're starting our December teaching series today, and we're going to do a series entitled, What Child Is This? And I love the kind of that we pick that, what child is this? Because if you think about it, it is the ultimate Christmas question. Like, we understand the manger, we understand Mary and Joseph, but then the question comes for each and every single one of us, what child is this to us inside of our lives? Like, who is Jesus to us? I mean, that's kind of the journey. And I even think about that original moment, what it must have been like. And I did some research, kind of researching back to the beginning of this song. And I found out that the song was written by this man right here, William Chatterton Dix. And I thought to myself originally, wow, he must have, you know, just loved God and he worked at a church and all these things and he must have wrote this song. But when I heard his story, I realized that his story was much different than I ever would have thought. In fact, Mr. Dix didn't even really like the church that much. And it was in the midst of a great sickness that God intervened in his life. Take 2 minutes and check this out.
William Chatterton Dix was born in 1837. He developed a passion for literature and poetry at a young age due to the influence of his father. He attended church in England, but was soured by its abundance of rules and lack of passion. He felt like the church wanted nothing to do with poetry and the passion that he loved. When William had completed his schooling, he moved to Scotland and got into business and quickly rose to success. Money had become his primary focus. At the age of 29, William suddenly became extremely ill and bedridden. The doctors had no idea of what the cause of the sickness was, but they were sure that it would eventually claim his life. He spent all his wealth trying to find a cure, but it did not work. After a few months, he gave up all hope and thought that he would never be well again. He fell into a deep depression. When he had reached bottom, God reached out to him and transformed his heart. He began to realize that God was not a distant, stale, passionless God, but rather an intimate, passionate God who cared deeply about him. From his bed, William started to write poem after poem, even though he thought he would still soon die. He knew that his purpose left on earth was to write poetry for the Lord, for his glory. A few months passed, and he found himself getting stronger and healthier. To his doctor's amazement, he eventually became well enough to go back to work. But this time, money was no longer important. His family encouraged him to put his poems to music. But because he was not musical, he paired a few poems with familiar melodies. One poem was called The Manger Throne. He put the lyrics over a traditional British melody known as Greensleeves, and with that, the song, What Child Is This?, was born. This beloved Christmas song was inspired by Matthew chapter 2, where it calls all Christians to turn from the ways of Herod, and like the shepherds and the magi, to raise the song on high to the Word made flesh, to the King of Kings, our salvation.
And so we think about that song today, What Child Is This? And now we realize kind of the source of where it came from. I don't know if you picked that up, but it came from a pretty rough spot. The doctor said, there's no hope. You're probably not going to get better. He had, even though he had done very well in his life, he had exhausted all of his finances trying to get better. You can imagine the prayers in that season. God, why? God, why? But yet he took that thing he was so passionate for, poetry, and began to write to the Lord. You know, while he was sick, they began to give him the Bible and different things for him to read, and he began and became inspired. And that's how we have that song today. And what I love the most is after he became whole again, the entire pursuit of his life changed. You know, sometimes God allows those tough moments to help define us, maybe realign us, maybe put us on the track that he's calling us to be on. Maybe even today you're in a tough spot. I want you to know, so was William Dix at one time. And it was in the midst of that bed that he changed his perspective. He changed his focus from his sickness to his God. Amen? And that one thing changed everything. And maybe even today, that's a step that we can take in our lives too. For us, what child is this? And I love the scripture that he was really thinking about and focusing on, because it was a time when people were looking to Jesus. And I love when we look at the Christmas story, the reality is that you can have that same question, but different people are going to answer it differently. Just like if I went around this room right now and I said, who is Jesus to you? That answer may change. That answer may be different. It has to do with what your experience has been with Christ up to this place where you are right now. And it was the same about the people in the original Christmas story. Like, I think back to the people that we think about as the wise men. What's another name for them? Magi. Okay, they're known as magi and they're known as wise men. Good. How many were there? No! We always think that there were three wise men. I kind of set you up for that one. Sorry. The reason they think that there were three is because of the gifts, right? Bonus points if we know the gifts. Gifts were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Exactly right. So a lot of times we get this picture of like these three kings coming up with these things. Well, probably actually the story is more like it was a caravan of people. It was a big deal, and the gold that they brought wasn't just this little thing. We're talking major gold. We're talking the kind of thing that you would bring a king. That's what these people brought. In fact, I don't want to jump too far ahead, but later in the story, after Jesus is born, his parents have to leave Nazareth, leave this whole Bethlehem, leave this whole place, and they have to go to Egypt. Well, how on earth could he get there? Well, there was a gift given by the Magi that allowed them to save that life, because Herod was out to kill him. But that's for a whole nother sermon. Let's get back to the wise men. Now, if we picked up their story in scripture, we can pick it up from Matthew chapter 2 and look at the first two verses, verse 1 and verse 2. It says this. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the Great, behold, wise men came from the east. They came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him." And so it's so interesting when you read this. Now, there are a couple of things that I want to pull out for you when we read this. So when we read they came from the east, maybe our temptation is to think they came from the east side of Bethlehem. No. Actually, that in the east was a term often used throughout Scripture, and it's believed by most that these magi that we're talking about here were most likely ancient astronomers from Babylon. So these are astronomers from Babylon that see the star come up and they realize that there is this king, and then they set off on a journey. Now here for me is kind of an interesting place too, when I wonder about the distance that it is from Babylon to get to a little place called Bethlehem. I now see that the approximation is between 700 and 900 miles. That is a long, long way. Amen? So no matter what, we see that these wise men had to travel a far distance to get there. That makes it kind of a big deal. It shows us that these weren't just three guys from the east side of town, that they traveled this long distance to see this King of Kings. And it tells us in Scripture that they saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. Almost the idea that they followed this star to Jesus. Now, here's my question for you. When do stars come out? At night, the one time you never wanted to travel, especially from Babylon to Bethlehem. To travel at night was unheard of. You would never, ever do that. So it adds more into the miracle, the connection that these magi, these wise men had to this journey that they were going on to get there. And you can imagine when they came into Jerusalem, there were so many of them that it became this major, major deal. In fact, it grew to the place where not only did the people see it, but it actually attracted the attention of the king. Now, they just followed a star. They had just followed what they knew in their heart to be true. And they began to share it when they got that. Where is the King of the Jews? Where are they at? Well, before you knew it, that message began to spread throughout Jerusalem. Everybody's talking about these magi who traveled in from Babylon. Everybody's talking about what was going on there. And the next thing you know, the king, King Herod, hears about it. And so King Herod says, "Hey, Magi, come here. We need to chat." And so the Magi and the king sit down, and the king finds out that they're there to find the King of the Jews. Now, there's a problem, because what was Herod's job title? King of the Jews. Legit, that was his job title. That's how he was known. He was the King of the Jews. But now Herod heard that there was a new person born, and this new person's title was what? King of the Jews. Herod is not too happy about that, but he's a good faker, right? And so we have this sentence right here. It tells us in Matthew 2, verse 8, "And he," King Herod, "sent them," the wise men, the magi, "to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may come and murder him.'" I don't want to ruin the ending for you, you know, but he's kind of lying right here. He's saying, I want to worship him. He's telling these wise men, "Oh, I want to do what you do. I want to worship this king of the Jews. This is important to me." And so he says, "Once you find him, I want you to come tell me so that I can go worship him." But the end of the story actually happens where these wise men are warned not to go back to tell Herod. Herod finds out about it. He sends all of his soldiers, or a lot of soldiers, into this city, and they kick in doors and they murder babies. That's atrocious, isn't it? Can you imagine the trauma that families in Bethlehem had to go through? He ordered the murder of every child 2 years or younger. And the soldiers had to go in and murder babies. That's what ends up happening. That's what King Herod does. That's how evil really King Herod was. But he lies to them. Now, here's what I need you to see, though, about this lie. Read the next verse. Right after he tells them this lie, watch what happens. It says, after listening to the king, they, the wise men, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. Isn't that beautiful? This is another miracle. Right? See, the Christmas story is filled with miracles. It's much more than Mary being a virgin that has a baby. There was miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle, and we have to begin to see it like that. This was an incredible miracle, a miracle that the star went and rested in the exact same spot where Jesus was. And what did they do? They followed the star. You know, that's really good for us to think about in our life, this idea about the star, this idea about knowing what to follow to get to the location where God is sending you. See, in all of our lives, we have to have a star. We have to have something that's leading us and guiding us. And here's the beautiful thing, that God has given a star for each and every single one of us, because navigating life isn't easy. Amen? I mean, it's easy when everything's going great, but here's the promise of life. It doesn't always go great. The one common denominator between each and every one of us is that we will have a difficult day. Or month, or year, or decade. Hopefully not a century, if you know what I mean. But we are going to have difficult days. But in our life, God helps us. He understands that. I love what Jason was talking about, because he talked about he understood what we went through. He understands what we go through. And he gives us leadership in our life today. But we have to look for it. See, just as the wise men had to look up in the sky and they had to look up in the star for the direction that they needed, there's a place for us to look too. And through scripture, I really see it in Psalm 119. You see, Psalm 119, verse 105 says this: your word is a light to my path. See, last week we talked about the path. I don't know if you remember, but last week Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we talked about, as a Christian, we want to follow and live the teachings of Jesus. See, really at the core of your Christianity, the question comes, am I doing what Jesus told me to do? If you want to know if you're on the path, answer that question. And so we have to know, how do I stay on the path? Now, last week we said sometimes when we look at what Jesus would have us do, we prefer to do what we want to do. Amen? Listen, that is called humanity. Stop beating yourself up for that. Wanting and having a desire to do something the opposite of what God wants, that is life. Like, there's this self-centeredness inside of us, and culture doesn't help. Come on, culture doesn't help, and surely Burger King doesn't help. Your way right away? No, that's not how life is supposed to be, right? Life, there's another option, another way. Now, we said if we choose the self way, we talked about this last week, we get off of the path and we end up rolling around in the jumping choya. You remember that? We're off the right path. We're getting hurt. Things are happening. And then what's the answer for us? It's to get back on the path. Now, here's kind of part two for us, is how do I get back on the path? Well, right here. Your word is a light to my path. So if we need to see the path, and if it's in darkness now, then we need some light. And I personally love the idea of thinking about God giving us light. Now, here's the problem for me, because I live in the 21st century, and I expect a floodlight. Amen? I want to see, you know. When I think about, like, those lights that are on lighthouses, like, that's what I want. I'm just, show me everything, God. I want to see it all. And maybe you're that way, too. Like, you want to know everything. Okay, this is the path you have for me, God, but what's going to happen next week and next month and next year and in 10 years? And what do you really want me to do? And we want to see that whole thing. The problem with that is that when we read Scripture, we have to look at it through the lens of culture, and they had not even created a mag light. By the time the psalmist wrote this down, I mean, it's no flashlights or nothing, right? Now, they did have light, so it wasn't an ignorant thought. I mean, they did have light, but we got to look at it through the context of the light that the hearers would have thought of when they heard that word. Your word is a light to my path. And a picture would have came to mind, except the picture would have been much different than mine. The picture would have been a picture of a lantern. That's what they used back then, lanterns. Lanterns and floodlights are quite different. They're very, very different. And I believe when I think about this verse, it's so understanding for me, the lantern picture. Because here's what the lantern picture shows us. See, the lantern shows us the next two steps. Three, if you got a good one, right? But not four and not five. And here's the crazy part about when I take the lantern and I allow it to see my steps, how am I going to see step six? By getting to step three, right? If it's only going to show me three steps, the only way that I can see step six is by going one, two, three. Now I can see steps four, five, and six. You see, but I couldn't see them before. And I think oftentimes in our lives, we find ourselves getting to a place where God is speaking to us. Maybe we read something in Scripture and God's like, that was for you. Now, if you're like me and you ever have found yourself where God is telling you to do something, oftentimes the thing God is encouraging us to do is something that we do not want to do. Amen? Have you read the Bible? Forgive your enemy? Yeah, right. And that's just one. I mean, just go on and on. But normally, I come to a place where I don't want to do what God is calling me to do. And I hope you've been there too, because here's what I want to tell you. It's okay. That's a normal phase of your faith. If you're there right now in front, it's okay. Like, just own that place where you are. You say no to God. Why? Because it's uncomfortable. Because you don't want to do it. Because I get in the way. If I do that, I'm going to feel less than. I don't want to be that way. I want them to serve me. I don't want to serve them. And we find ourselves kind of upside down. And so oftentimes in our life, it's really just having the courage to say, okay, God. And here's the beautiful thing. As you take those next three steps, you're never taking those three steps alone. Like, God is with you. He gives you the strength to do the things that you're called to do. And here's the one thing that I've found. When I do what Jesus tells me to do, my life improves. It doesn't make sense, but it does. There's this verse in Scripture where it says, if you remember someone has a beef with you, that means an issue, a problem, they don't like you, all right? If they got issue with you, here's what Jesus said. You go make things right with them. Now, here's the problem. I live in America, and that's not the way things work. No, they did it wrong. They messed up. They were mean to me. They need to come. But Jesus says, no, you come. Because, see, your integrity as Christians is not to be dictated by the actions of others. I'm going to say that again so it can sink in. Your integrity as a Christian is not to be dictated by others. In other words, it doesn't matter what they did. I'm going to do what Jesus is calling me to do. See, that's Christianity. And that's what makes it so difficult. That's what makes it so hard. Because we live in a culture where we just want to do what we want to do. We want to defend ourselves and make them pay. I'm taking it a little too far. All right, so, you know, Scripture, though, it talks about in the book of Hebrews. And here's how it describes God's word. And I think this is really great. The word of God is living and active. I'm just going to pause there. God's word is alive. I've read the Bible multiple years in a row, right? Every time I get something out of it. And oftentimes, it's the same verse I've read a million times that for some reason God uses it to smack me around a little bit. It's alive, living, and active. That's what God's word is, if you let it in. And then it goes on to say this, sharper than any double-edged sword, it penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Listen, we talk about this a lot. You know, the transformation that God does, there's two big words, justification. The minute you became a Christian, God rips you out of darkness and places you into light. You get there through your faith in him. God, please forgive me. I repent. I turn to you. Justification. But then there's this other side of things, and it's called sanctification. And what it is, it's that lifelong process of transformation, right? It's what God is doing consistently in our lives. It's why you're not the same person today that you were 10 years ago if you've been following Jesus. That Jesus has been cleaning you up. Amen? Amen. And guess what? He cleaned you up by some of you saying yes, even though you didn't want to. By some of you saying, okay, God, I'll do that. It's hard. Will you please help me forgive them? Will you please help me have that conversation? Will you please help me be honest about this demon in my closet? Will you help me? Whatever it is, it's that place. But I need you to see this about God's word. God's word is about judging the thoughts and attitudes of what? The heart, right? See, this is the most important thing in your life. Jesus talked about it. See, as Christians, a lot of times, especially in culture, Christians want to look at people's hands. Well, what are you doing? Don't do that anymore. Stop doing that. Start doing this. You need to do this. Stop doing that. And a lot of times, and we're ready to beat people up for what they're doing. We're ready to tear them down. Talk about how they ain't even Christian because of what they're doing or this or that. You know, we're quick to do that. Now, here's the problem. Jesus always talks about hearts. He said, you've heard it said, don't murder someone. But I tell you, if you harbor hatred in your heart, you've already committed murder. You've heard it said, do not commit adultery. But I tell you, if you lust, if you hold that lust in your heart, right, that you've already committed adultery. See, it's always about focusing here, and that's what God's word does. It helps us kind of grab the pickaxe and just start digging at our heart. And here's what you're going to find out. When you surrender this heart to Jesus, there are plenty of opportunities for him to prune it. Amen? In other words, there's lots of work that we can do in this area right here. Because let me tell you, life sometimes messes up our hearts. You don't believe me? Think about the last person who did you wrong. Think about the person who betrayed you. Did that affect the way you treated others? Yeah. Did that affect the level of trust you had for other people? Yeah. See, the things that we experience here that we hold on to, they affect these hands. And so when I'm looking at my life, I realize, wow, God's word is very, very important because it wants to do a work here. And the only way that I can truly have change in my life is by changing this heart. Because when you go from a place of hatred to love here, it changes everything. When you go from a place of I'm here to be served to no, I am here to serve. When you're out, that's going to change the way that you act. Guess what? You're going to get a little less upset about someone not being a good enough server for you, person for you, driver for you. Amen? So I'm driving. He's like, I'm not even going to say the roundabout. I'm not saying it this week. I'm not. But you think about that. What is that? That's right here. And you look at it like God gives us the opportunity to work on it here. But what do we need sometimes? Sometimes we want to do the work, but we don't have the answers. Why? The answer is in God's word. It's in God's word. And I just really want to encourage each and every single one of you to start that. And then sometimes people look at me and, well, what does that look like? I had a great brother come to me the other day. And he was like, do you know that there's 24 chapters in the book of Luke? And if you start reading a chapter a day on Christmas Eve, you'll know the entire story of Jesus. And I thought to myself, man, now that's an encouragement. You know, in Advent, which we're meeting every single day, Monday through Friday from 5 to 5:30, to do what? To just focus on Jesus. You're invited. If you ever want to, if you haven't made yet, don't worry if you haven't come yet. Just start fresh on Monday. You could come for that 20 minutes, 20, 25 minutes. Just come here and adjust your heart. But when you begin to look right here and surrender that to God, this is when God begins to work. And so maybe for some of us, we're like, okay, December. Maybe that's, I'm challenging you right now. Maybe read the book of Luke. A chapter a day, that's all it is. It won't take you more than 5 minutes. If you like watching TV, mute the commercials. I don't care, right? It has to be better than what you're watching, I guarantee. And just go through that one a day. And then here's my encouragement for you. If at the end of December, your heart's been touched by what you read, if at the end of December, you're closer to God than you were at the beginning, then I would encourage you, let's move on to the book of John. Let's move on to the book of Matthew. Let's move on to the book of Mark. Those are the four books I'd really love for you to read, because if you want to be a Christian, Christian literally means Christ-like. And what that means is that we're going to live out the teachings that Jesus Christ gave in everything that he taught. And so to be a Christian, we kind of have to know what he taught. When I first became a Christian, I still remember this. You know, I had my moment where I walked down and I prayed a prayer, but before that, I read the Bible. Not the whole thing. I just read the book of John, I think it was, or Matthew. And for me, I fell in love with Jesus. I remember telling my friends, I was not religious at all, but I would tell my friends, I'd follow that guy anywhere. He's the real deal. This is even before, like when I just learned the teachings of Jesus Christ. I was like 19 years old, and it changed my life. That's what the power of Jesus Christ. And I just want to encourage you, allow Jesus' teachings to come, plant themselves in your heart, and then live the rest of your life. Every day that you have breath, just say, I want to stay on his path. How do I stay on his path? By living my life according to the way that Jesus Christ taught me to live. And when I live according to Jesus' teaching, I'm going to stay on his path. I promise you this, you stay on his path, you will never be disappointed. You will have hard days, but you will never have to face that hard day alone, because God will be with you on every mountaintop, and he'll also be with you in every valley. I encourage you this Christmas, draw close to him and let him have his way in your heart. Amen? Amen. Bow your heads. Let's pray.